Evening all on Play Chess and streaming to YouTube as well. Okay, so we're going to look in this week's broadcast at Natalia Polgonia, who I keep pronouncing incorrectly in a lot of videos on YouTube, Pogonina. I think it's actually, and I listened to this several times actually on chessgames.com, because chessgames.com you can hear the pronunciation from an expert. I believe it's Natalia Polgonia. That's as close as I think I'm going to get. So anyway, so who is she? She is one of the top Russian women grandmasters currently playing in an international team event. She had a fantastic tournament at Gibraltar earlier this year, just in February, I think, Gibraltar. So the Gibraltar tournament is played at the Kalita Hotel, and it's a very, very attractive tournament, attracting actually many strong grandmasters. I played there once, and it was a fantastic experience, and I'd recommend to anyone, if they can afford it, to try at least once. So Natalia managed to do so well. She got to play many of the greatest players in the tournament. And one of them was Nigel Short, who has actually won this tournament once or twice before, maybe even more. So Nigel Short has been a regular at this tournament. And Natalia was playing him in round 7 and kicked off with e4. So what would Nigel Short do? Well, Nigel Short actually played the Kurakan defence, so c6. And Natalia kind of complimented Nigel by playing a system which Nigel Short himself would use quite often against the Kurakan. And so how does this go? Well, d4, d5, and playing e5. Now, there was once a classic game played between Nimzowitsch and Capablanca, where Nimzowitsch was totally outplayed playing this, because sometimes if you lose the light square bishops, c4 and f5 can be more sensitive than usual. But Nigel Short invigorated this system by putting the bishop on e2 and not having this exchange. And, you know, he used it with great success. And Natalia actually uses this very same system now. So bishop f5, now knight f3. And black has some piece development congestion issues. Although the bishop looks to be outside the pawn chain, and maybe black in theory can play like this as though it's an improved French defense, there are specific issues with congestion of pieces here which need to be addressed. So e6, bishop e2, so not wanting this swap of the lion square bishops. Now black actually played, now Nigel Short played h6, so he's playing against his own system, so it's interesting to see what he does. Natalia just castled, and now knight e7, okay, blocking in the bishop for a moment. Knight bd2, knight d7, so not in any hurry to do something with this bishop or move the knight yet. It looks as though c5 might be on the cards. And actually, I'm going to add a kibitzer here, just for my own clarity, thinking, actually not Fritz though. I think another one might be good. Hang on, let's just add, I've got Houdini on this machine. Okay, let's add Houdini. So black looks to be looking for c5. It looks to be an improved French defense in theory, but the development issues aside, the bishop's outside the pawn chain with pressure on d4. You think that would be attractive. Okay. But white closes that possibility a bit with knight b3, so putting a grip on c5. And we see now bishop g6, which vacates f5, so the knight can perhaps come to f5. With the queen on d8, any g4 might be answerable with knight h4, the queen protecting h4. So this seems plausible here. White plays a4, and now we see this knight f5. So the queen eyeing here, g4 in general would weaken white's king in any way. So the pawn on h6 is okay instead of h5, because this is, I don't think this is a serious issue here. So white actually played now a5, increasing a kind of dark square grip on the queen's side. A6. And now we see c4 from Natalia. This could be seen potentially as a strategic risk if black's able to play taking and use the d5 square. But with b6 unavailable, it would seem hard to imagine at the moment how one of these knights could sit prettily on d5. In fact, Nigel just leaves that. He doesn't play d takes c4. He plays bishop e7. And now, a very interesting move indeed, closing the queen side a bit and preventing black from playing c5 on a more permanent basis, c5. So this looks to be quite an original and committal way of playing against one of the UK's strongest ever grandmasters. So blocking the queen side like this, will this prove to be too much of a controversial decision? Black castles, h3. So with the queen side totally blocked, black now undermines e5 and potentially is generating some f-file counterplay. White now does kick the knight with g4, because f6 did actually take away knight h4 as a possibility. But this is Nigel's entire conception here, that g4, there's a very, very interesting move played by black in this position, and very, very dangerous indeed. And well, before we look at f6, let's just for a moment consider this position. If black doesn't play f6, white stands a little bit better. If we gave black a move, queen c7. Okay, without f6, how is black actually generating some counterplay? Just want to highlight that. So f6, g4. Black's idea was actually to sacrifice the piece now, because where is the knight going? It can't go back. It hasn't got h4. The idea was to sacrifice a piece. So one pawn for the knight. G takes f5. Bishop takes f5. Now in return, there's an isolated pawn here. White's king safety is slightly damaged. The c5 is slightly loosened if d4 is going to be taken away. So there's a potential to weaken some more pawns here. But this is the important one for king safety, you'd think. And Natalia protects that one, king g2. So a very exciting, dynamic game now. Can Natalia weather this storm on the f-file? Bishop e4, pinning the knight. Black is now threatening simply to play e takes d4 and then continue with extra possibilities now to maybe exert pressure on the pin like this. It starts to be dangerous. Knight bd2. So challenging that bishop. So now here on e takes d4, I think white can just play knight takes, break that pin and just take on d4. And there won't be any major punishment here. So actually on this move, Nigel actually committed to giving up that pin with bishop takes f3 and knight square bishop. Knight takes f3, but now e4. So black's center control is a bit of a menace with this spearhead pawn. So black clearly has some compensation for the piece. It's very interesting. Knight h2, tucking the knight here, seems quite neat as a defensive idea. e5, so undermining again white's structure. Very interesting, unique game here, with white committing to closing up the queen side only for this piece sac now to erupt and undermine these pawns. f3 now, a gutsy move to play. So white wants to share that f-file and undermine this spearheaded pawn. e takes d4, f takes e4. The engines have the position about equal here. Houdini reckons it's about equal. Very difficult position to be playing a piece up, because king safety is one major issue, and losing some more pawns like knight takes c5 is another. Actually, Nigel plays rook takes f1, knight takes f1. And now takes on c5. We see now e takes d5. Queen takes. Bishop f3. At the moment, actually, the engine even potentially likes black a little bit. It's a difficult position for white to play. If black could get organized, this attack is going to be really dangerous. Queen d6. Very important key defensive move, king h1. Now, so here, okay, is this g-file going to be used? Is the bishop going to retreat back? Or maybe even stuff like this, maybe, to try and use the g-file against black. Might be on the cards one day. Rook f8. In fact, the rook switches to a3 to protect f3 like this, to free up the queen. Queen e5. And it looks as though black is up to naughty stuff here, with knight e4 on the cards, and maybe bishop d6, or just queen f5. Looks a little bit dangerous. b4, the knight goes to e4. So immediate threat, knight f2 check, winning the queen. What does white do? Queen e2 parries that, just about. Bishop d6, looking at h2, and all the stuff at the moment is protected. The rook's supporting the bishop, so there's no rook takes f3. I mean, the knight's on h2 at the moment. So king g1 was played. Rook e8. Now white actually commits to simplifying here with bishop takes e4. So taking away potential of getting quickly mated. Queen takes e4, rook takes e4. And in theory, a piece up. But in practice, how does white actually do this? Black's got potential passed pawn here, 2-1, and weakness on b4 to consider. Bishop d2, holding b4, rook e2. Rook d3, target, bishop e5. Rook f3, what is white up to? Well, maybe rook f2 to evict this pesky rook here on the 7th. g5, rook f2, eviction notice, rook e4. And now the king steps forward away from the dark squares, which is sometimes a good idea. The opponent's got a particular bishop to get away from tactically. Prophylaxis. King g7. Now rook f3 was played. So white's waiting a little bit. Check, rook f2. And now Nigel actually exchanges rooks and plays king f6. So can this knight do anything against black's pawn armada? Potential pawn armada. Bishop e1. King f5, the king is getting quite aggressive. Knight d2, keeping the king out of e4, bishop d6. Now knight c4 protects b4 and hits the bishop, bishop e7. King e2, an ideal blockading square perhaps, but what about this 2-1 here? King e4, taking away d3. Knight b2, the knight can reroute d3. h5. Black works on his pawn majority. Knight d3, blockade. Bishop d6, bishop d2, hitting g5. g4. It's still difficult for white. A piece up. Can Natalia hold? H takes, h takes. The pawns are all on light squares. It's very difficult for this bishop to try and munch pawns. Knight f2 check. King f5. King d3. Now black played g3, and this is very dangerous actually. Knight h3 is played. King g4. The knight steps back. c5. Undermining potentially a5. That's taken. Bishop takes. Bishop e1. g2. King c4. The bishop drops back, and king d3. White's waiting a little bit. It's a bit of a long, protracted struggle here. Bishop b8, bishop f2. Bishop goes to attack this one to get two potential passed pawns here. Bishop e1, protecting for a moment. Now knight e2. King h3. So this is quite serious. Knight f4 check. And Natalia actually commits now to getting rid of this pawn. Her king can now potentially try and venture to stop these. King takes. It's looking a bit easier potentially to try and draw this position. King e2, king c4. Bishop c7. King b3. This looks drawable now. As soon as black ever plays this, this bishop can always be sacrificed. The bishop is on the queening square, but it's not going to happen, it seems. And the game continued a little bit more like this. And to the amusement of the spectators, apparently, Nigel Short announced here checkmate in this final move, 6d8. But the observant among you might notice it's not checkmate. White has a crucial saving resource here. White can play 8-8 and it's a draw. So they actually agreed a draw here with b5 check. So I think this is a fantastic game from Natalia against one of Britain's strongest ever grandmasters, Nigel Short, who has actually got a fantastic record as well in the Gibraltar tournament. So let's now look at some other interesting games. So this one I thought was very, very interesting for the peace sacrifice and weathering the storm, showing great defensive ability to weather the tactical storm. Very dynamic play from Black, and White played very calmly there. Natalia is on YouTube. Hi, Natalia. did I say anything relevant to this game? I don't know if my comments were okay. So this was one of your great games, wasn't it, from Gibraltar? You did enjoy this against Nigel Short. Yeah, the dog is barking in the background, I'm afraid. Yeah. So how did you do today? Did you draw today? You're playing in the team championship today. You drew today, I hope, or you won or something. I hope it was good news today. And you're going to be playing. Do you think you'll be playing this Gibraltar next year? You seem to have a great time in it this year, anyway. So I've got one or two to look at as well. Another one or two from this tournament this year. So Natalia also played Vasily Ivanchuk in this tournament, but that was a great struggle, but maybe another time for that. Here is another game, if I can load it, against Xander Wemmers. Okay, so this was in round 5. Natalia playing White, e4. You drew to that, great. So d6. So after d4, knight f6, you Natalia, I'm about to say you played. I'll keep saying Natalia played f3. So this is very interesting. So often bishop e3 and try and get rid of this bishop and hack attack sometimes. So d5, Black struck in the center here, and it changes the whole nature of the position to be like a French defense, Tarrasch variation. So what has Natalia got against the Tarrasch? E5, knight fd7, f4, and we have a French defense structure. C5, c3. Now sometimes this kind of attacking structure is really quite pleasant for the attacking player, as long as the center is not going to be blown up anytime soon. So knight c6, bishop e2, and now Black played queen b6, all thematic against d4. Now White would sometimes like to reinforce d4 with this, but sometimes you have to be careful not to get more damage to your pawn structure. We see castling. For the moment, the pawn chain is intact. It's not going to be blown up any second at the moment. Bishop e7, king h1, getting away from this dangerous diagonal. And now, after Black castled, White now sneaks in. White now sneaks in knight a3 to try and strengthen the pawn chain. And technically, Houdini gives this as a tiny advantage for White here. Black did play c takes d4, as though there might be some risk of bishop takes a3. But I don't think this is such a big deal here. Bishop takes a3, gives up the bishop pair, and Black's going to be weak on the dark squares after, surely. What the engine likes White here in this position. It's not just, it's simply not worth it. I think maybe there's stuff like this, and we can dominate the dark square. So it's not worth it at the moment. The pawn chain's not that bad. So this knight can come to c2, it seems. Black now does an interesting rerouting of knights. Knight db8. I once saw this backward maneuver in a French defense game of Michael Adams many years back. I was really impressed. The problem is this bishop. How do we develop this bishop? By going backwards to the knight, the bishop can come to d7, and then the knight might be able to come like this, and then use the c file for the rooks. So black's play is going to be on the queen side usually. Knight c2. But f6 is played, which might have a potential downside. It slightly weakens actually the king side sometimes. If this bishop's going to get onto this diagonal later, this whole diagonal could be quite dangerous for black. b3 for a moment. And now we see a5. Knight e3. And this looks as though white could actually, with knight e3, consider e takes and knight g4 to e5, possibly. Black actually plays f takes e5. And now we see d takes e5. This is an interesting way of capturing. I think f takes might have been plausible as well. Now, you might think that loose pawn is immune here. Rook takes f4. We can play knight takes d5, hitting the queen and the rook. Forget that. That pawn's not on. Black actually played bishop c5. And now, actually, there is, from an engine perspective, I should mention this, knight g5, a bit of a tactical opportunity to actually look at h7. This wasn't played. Bishop takes e3, queen d3 is good for white, apparently. That would be collecting the dark square bishop. This seems plausible. You might think h6. I think there are often nifty tactics with this structure against h7. Here, knight takes d5. This is just engine territory. Just quickly to have a quick look at this. This kind of stuff might have been interesting. It's from an engine perspective. It's using the aggressive pawn chain. But as humans, it's very, very difficult to think about such moves. The knight just retreated, actually, in the game. Knight c2. But knight g5 was tactically interesting. Now we see knight a6. So black can use that c file on the b4 square. There seems to be a big grip on it. The bishop does go to look at h7 now. And it looks as though white might be threatening knight g5. And in case, or even the Greek gift might be on, potentially. Black gets maybe a bit nervous about that with g6. So blunting the bishop for a moment, knight g5. And there's a clear threat of knight takes h7 and queen h5 check here. This needs to be parried. Black plays queen c7, protecting h7 with the queen. And we see here a3 taking away b4 for a moment. Queen g7, the queen lends the support to the king side. Queen g4. I like the general feel of white's attacking position here. It's got an aesthetic for me. This rook is potentially a bit of a liability on this f file. At the moment it's protected by the bishop, but watch out for that. Knight d4 is played. And a very interesting move, b4. Potentially there's a pin on that knight, or white gaining valuable time for an attack here. This is an ingenious move, actually. Black actually played knight takes c2, and after bishop takes c2, black didn't dare take this pawn. If a takes, okay, we have the pin on the knight to win the exchange, so forget knight takes, but bishop takes you might be wondering about. I think white stands better here. You look at this bad bishop here. The engine suggests bishop e3. And then can continue even on the queen side with rook fb1, if nothing else. And this could be very, very pleasant for white indeed. But black played a more testing move here. After he played bishop, I assume it's he, bishop d4, hitting the rook. Technically, we're about equal here. Rook b1, protecting b4. But there's a tactic. That was a tactic, actually, because the bishop is not protecting here. So black now plays bishop takes e5. Whoa. The thing is, there's a downside to this materialistic move here, that this e6 pawn can be under greater scrutiny with queen e2, staring at e6 if the bishop moves, protecting the rook. Bishop moves. Knight takes e6. And now white has on the cards f5, which looks like a potential crunching attacking move. And in fact, after queen e7, it is played. It looked pretty juicy to me, f5. So how does it actually work? Well, black didn't play g takes f5. You might think, well, the knight's pinned, isn't it, to the queen. Well, it doesn't matter, bishop takes f5. And this is pretty nice, this is pretty present. With queen g4 now introduced, that's really quite dangerous for black. So it doesn't matter about the rook, it's just the possibility of queen g4. It's a great attacking position. Look at these bishops. So anyway, after f5, a takes b4 was played. And white just gains time for the attack with bishop h6. So really looking at that rook now to move, rook e8. And now a great move indeed. Forget about taking this pawn. That might actually be quite bad. If white just took the pawn here, in fact, g takes f5 is pretty nasty. So that has to be avoided. That knight would be a tactical liability. No, the idea here, queen f3, great move. So black is in some difficulties here. With the knight now free to move, black does accept this pawn on a3 first, but now knight f4 hits d5 and g6 is under great scrutiny. This pawn chain here. So in fact, the engine has changed evaluation at move 30 massively in white's favor to over plus 5 here. Black has just seemingly blundered horrifically, technically, by playing b takes. Knight f4, massive advantage. So what on earth causes this massive advantage? Well, if black loses the dark square bishop, this could be telling. Bishop takes f5, knight takes d5, about to win the dark square bishop, queen e6. But there's something even more painful here than simply taking the bishop. In fact, where could the queen have gone to maintain the bishop? There wasn't too many alternatives which allow this crushing move. Can you spot it on YouTube? Is anyone awake there? White to play. What does white play in this position? Although it looks as though there's a dangerous pawn, by the way, but this, it looks as though it's tempting just to eliminate that bishop. But white to play here. If I gave you 20 seconds, what would you play in this position? Anyone? Okay, it's not so complex, so I'm going to just show you. I hope you get it right. Rook b6, yes, crushing. So this is winning the queen, actually, for 2 bits. Queen takes, knight takes, otherwise the bishop would just be lost. a2, is there any hope for this? With this bishop eyeing a1? No, because bishop b3 check, snuffing that pawn out. Check, killer check. Taking on a2. Black plays on a little bit. Rook ad8. And now we see the knight returning with a vengeance. Bishop b2. Bishop g5 now. Hitting the rook. The rook moves. Now knight e7 is played. Threatening real damage with knight takes f5. Rook f8. Bishop h6. The bishop drops back. And that's taken. And now queen takes b7, threatening knight takes f5, check. Rook d7. And is this a little trap? No, white can have just played knight takes f5, but also this is very good. Queen b2 check. After king h6, queen c1 check. And black is getting mated, black resigned here. There's a mate in 12 apparently, so I'll show you the mate in 12. King g7, check, king h6, knight takes, we take on f5, and throw in this check, and then we can take here, and if takes, just to shorten it, check, for example, and we can just mate with with well, it's just winning. So anyway, it's over. Resistance is over. When it's mopping up. So a crushing game there from Natalia. So it's sort of transposed into a French defense Tarrasch variation, which sometimes to me seems very, very comfortable for this pawn chain. So playing with that aggressive pawn chain is sometimes, I think, a pleasure to many attacking players. okay, so that's one of the, in fact, this pawn chain, you know, some people are so attracted to it that that's one reason for playing the Tarrasch. But of course, Black can keep away from this with like the open Tarrasch, etc. But in this game, White really enjoyed a nice space advantage. Okay, so let's see. Now, so that was against Wemmers. Oh, hang on. There's another one here from Gibraltar I'd like to show you. So this was against Nino Mazarats in round 4. Natalia was playing Black. So we see d4, knight f6, knight f3. And this is really dull system from White. It should be banned or something. I don't know. So how to play against it? So d5 was played. Solid. So meet solid with solid. c4, e6. Knight c3. Bishop e7. So very classical response. Bishop f4. White is trying to torture with this kind of stodge strategy. Just the bishop, that London system bishop torturing on the diagonal. Black castles, e3. Now we see a Tartakower type response. Just sort out this bishop with b6. We see c takes d5 from White. And Natalia, for the moment, well, I think this is theory actually, to take with the knight rather than the pawn. Livebook has this much more frequently than taking with the pawn. Knight takes, e takes. After bishop d3, c5. Knight e5. And now Natalia played c takes d4. After e takes d4, there's a tactical opportunity to interrupt things now. Bishop b4 check. And okay, you might ask, why can't White play bishop d2 here? Let's have a quick look. In the game, king f1 was played. If bishop d2, well, Black apparently has a good game just taking here and then playing f6 to kick that knight. And then we can throw in the check here. And I think Black's doing very, very well in this position. So bishop b4 check, king f1. I think this is more, this has actually been played before, king f1. The bishop drops back to d6 now. Bishop a6 is on the cards to get rid of that light square bishop. We see queen h5 though, forcing a response here. I'm not sure g6 is a bit worrying to play g6. I think White can actually just play knight takes g6 here. So this is to be avoided. After takes, this could get nasty. So Natalia did well not to play this because bishop takes d6 and it's looking very nasty indeed. You don't want this position. So instead, Natalia plays in response to this f5. Okay, it looks as though there's a slight compromise here. The e5 square is slightly weakened, but it's necessary to make that concession. h4, White is on the attacking rampage here. Now, Natalia give up the dark square bishop. Perhaps White should have played bishop takes e5 here. And after knight c6, reinforced the bishop, possibly. White instead played d takes e5. And we see knight c6, rook h3. This attack looks dangerous though. King h8, rook g3. Queen e7 is played. And now perhaps White should have tried playing on the queen side with rook c1 a little bit. But actually, rook e1 was played. Bishop e6, blockade. Keep things closed. Rook g5. maybe a bit of committal. It's attacking f5, but this is nicely defended with queen f7. And volunteering the exchange of queens. I'm not sure white would enjoy that position with the exchange of queens. Although perhaps white should have played this, the engine suggests this might be the best move to take the queens off. Maybe white had attacking intent and didn't want to play like this, but this might have been quite good for white, this position here. Instead, we see the queen retreating to f3. Now Natalia plays knight b4 after bishop b1. Here is a fantastic little plan now. Knight a6. The knight notes that these two pawns are quite useful for this maneuver. That would be very nice to get in. Indeed, a knight on e4. And it's difficult for white to actually prevent it. h5, and the knight comes into e4. It's a juicy little knight outpost here. Sorry, isn't there a stream? Sorry, what's happened on you? On, I thought it has been streaming. So the knight's coming to e4. And white now played h6. h6, quite committal. g6, black does stand better. This does block things. So no immediate open lines. Queen c3 was played here. Rook a c8. Black is standing more and more comfortably. Queen d4. Now knight e4. So a lovely little maneuver there to get the knight to e4. And actually, with white king on f1, this is a bit controversial if f takes is ever allowed. And in fact, white gets fed up here with that knight. Can't bear it at the moment. If white played king g1, well, black's better now. Rook c4, for example, and then dominating that c file, this could be really quite dangerous. There's nothing for white to attack here. So white actually committed to taking on e4, but now this dangerous f file. But the thing is, black actually inserted rook c4 first, and now took on e4, so hitting the bishop. Black is doing very well and blundered here. Theoretically, the bishop should have just dropped back. If bishop e3, there's still some work to do, quite a bit of work to do potentially, but white blundered on move 28 with b3. But it's only a blunder because of the fantastic move Natalia played here. Can you spot what that was? So black to play a real bone crushing, king's crushing move. Yeah. Natalia says it's very important to enjoy any position in chess, even when you're worse. So this is a very enjoyable position now for Natalia, I think. So Natalia also comments on YouTube stream, otherwise one might get annoyed and self-destruct quickly. Happens all the time. So a brilliant move in this position to celebrate this f file. So that's a little clue. So black to play, what would you play in this position if I gave you 20 seconds starting from now? Black to play. King c2 is not a legal move for black. Come on, more tries. Anyone? All right, I hope some of you are going to get this. I'm going to show you now. Okay. Oh, you might have meant this. Sorry, you might have meant this move with the notation. Okay, it is on c2. The move rook c2 just deflect the queen away. And it's crushing after queen takes f4. So where is the rook moving? Where? The thing is, the problem is, if queen c1, there's queen takes f2 mate. If the rook moves, there's queen takes g3 now. The rook is stranded on g5. That's the point. The rook stranded. White plays rook c1. It's lost. Queen takes g5. Queen c7, well, trying for a last cheapo. That's extinguished. Queen takes h6. And now white resigned. So a bit of a crushing game there in the end. So very nice, neat tactics. And nice knight maneuver, I thought. Hope you enjoyed that one. I think Natalia must have. She'll probably comment. Okay, so now let's go to Natalia's in the Russian team championship at the moment. Let's go to a few years back in the Russian team championship. So she was playing, Natalia was playing Ketevan Arekmir Grant, I think, who has played a lot in the UK quite a bit. So about the same FIDE rating at the time. Natalia playing white, actually. E4 was played. Natalia's mentioned something here. Also, she says on YouTube, you can also tell yourself that it wasn't you who reached that bad position. Just think of it as a study. Some sort of training helps a lot in defending inferior positions. So fantastic grandmaster tips here. Thanks, Tonya. So I don't know if you remember this vividly, this game in 2010, Tonya. So you're playing white against Ketevan Arekmir Grant. So I think Scotland. So e4, c5. It's a Sicilian defense. And you played the open Sicilian. And after knight c3, d6. And we see bishop e2. Okay, knight f6. After castling, bishop e7. So it's a classical system, king h1. So white's getting rid of the king on that dangerous diagonal, preparing f4 usually. So f4 now. Bishop d7. And now bishop e3. Knight takes d4, bishop takes d4, bishop c6. Now this game, I've chosen it because actually it's on the chess games commas as one of Tony's more notable games. I think it was quite interesting. So bishop c6, it looks like a nice attacking position. Bishop d3, so the bishop's glaring down potentially. So the queen could join in potentially with queen f3 or queen e1. So we see knight d7, and in fact queen e1 is played. So the queen can head now for g3 to ig7. So black blunts that diagonal with e5. Bishop drops back for a moment. E takes, bishop takes. Knight e5. Rook d1. Now bishop f6. So black's strong pointing e5 for a moment. Natalia now preserves the light square bishop just in case with bishop e2. So bishop e2. At the moment, it doesn't look as though there's too many prospects for that bishop. E4 supported well enough, and there is a bind on d5, and potential for knight d5 to be quite a juicy move now. So the rook's looking and supporting knight d5. We see rook c8, queen g3. Bishop h6 might be an annoying idea, potentially. In this position, potentially. Let's just check this. In the game, queen e7 was played, because I think the engine's up to something here. Let's have a look at a6. Bishop here, and if here, rook takes. And if queen takes, Rook takes d6. This is the kind of tactical disaster which might occur from an engine perspective anyway. So that's pretty vicious. Something to bear in mind. So actually queen e7 was played. So I think now bishop h6 is not such a big deal. Black can actually play something like knight g6. Okay, that's not a big deal. So after queen e7, we have rook d2. White could actually just play positioning, maybe just to gang up on d6 now. A6. So b5 might be quite interesting. A4, trying to discourage that. Black's going to end up with an isolated pawn if b5 now, or just lose the pawn. Rook fd8, rook fd1, ganging up on d6. Queen e6. H3, taking away some squares, potentially waiting for black to see what black's doing. Knight c4. And now the bishop finds a skewer line. This is an unfortunate move. Weakness of the last move. Ouch. Bishop g4. Or is it? Because black was attacking the rook. So, what's going on here? The board has caught fire tactically. What has gone on here? Well, let's see. So, queen e8. Bishop takes c8. Knight takes d2. And this is getting a little bit dangerous, actually, for white to be actually worse. You might think rook takes d2 might be viable. Actually, the engines don't like rook takes d2. Rook takes, bishop takes. Black might be okay with bishop takes e4. With bishop takes c3 to follow. This could be quite dangerous, this position here. Natalia plays a better move, it seems. Technically, bishop takes b7. Desperado kind of tactic. Bishop takes b7, rook takes d2. This is a much better position than what I've just shown you. But now black still persists in taking e4 with bishop takes c3. Queen takes e3. Queen takes e4. So it looks a little bit dangerous on things, but the rook's holding g2 for a moment. Queen g3. D6 is eyed up here. But what about this pawn? Well, queen takes a4. But now, actually, this is a howler of a move technically, and Natalia taps into its problem. There's a big problem here with queen takes a4. This could be the major blunder of the game, actually. Whilst before I showed you a quite a devastating computer tactic with bishop h6, it does show the sensitivity of g7 in this whole line. But queen takes a4. Bishop h6. It's actually crushing this position now. We're at plus 13. What has black done to have such a lost position? Well, the dark squares have had it after this move. Bishop h6. It can't be defended, it seems, very easily. Black tries g6. And Natalia, you missed a really clinical move here, I've got to say. It's easy with my engine to point out. No, you played a really clinical move as well, queen c3. Yeah, she just blundered, I think. Yeah, queen c3, that's good enough. And you're in there on the dark squares. yeah. Okay, so this is over. F6, queen takes f6. Queen d7. And now, neat finish though, rook f2. So threatening queen f8. And that can't be stopped. So it's a neat finish. I think this is why it made it, Natalia, into the Chess Gamescom notable games. Chess Gamescom on your page there. I think they must have liked this finish. Or it might have been a puzzle of the day at some point. But there's no way of stopping queen f8. If queen here, we just mate here. If any other move, we just play queen f8 and we're mating. So disaster on the dark squares. Yes, I was going to point that out, but I wasn't sure if you'd appreciate it. was this move queen e5 instead. Apparently this is a mate in 6 instead of the mate in 8. Okay, so queen e5 is even quicker apparently. So if it was to be dragged out like this, okay, taking it, this is the computer defense, and we have this forced mate. Yeah, so queen e8 was more precise. Queen e5 was more precise. So on queen c3 there was f6. On queen e5, if f6 was played here, then it's a mating free with check, and then queen takes f6. So yeah, that's why this is actually more accurate than that. Just for theoretical interest, queen e5 is actually more accurate than queen c3. Okay. I thought it was a neat game anyway. Yes, both moves are mating by force. Yeah. Now, there's another game in the title. I don't know why they've gone back in time. I hope you don't mind this one. We can do other games maybe another time that you've played as well. But this goes back in time, way back in time, to 1998. Into the European Championship under 14 girls tournament, where I can't believe it, Antonia, you had a FIDE rating of 2501, and you outgraded your opponent by 500 points in this game, who was Karine Roly. So let's have a look. So e4, this made it for some reason as one of your notable games. So please forgive me for taking this older game. I think you've commented on it as well at Chess Gamescom at some point. So an open Sicilian, a6, bishop d3, knight c6, knight takes c6, b takes, c4, d5. Now Antonia took on d5 and castled. So here, okay, one question is, what happens if d takes e4? Well, bishop takes e4, and white doesn't mind any queen exchange here. I think this is great for white. This position, white's it's an enormous position. If here bishop b6, this is a nightmare for black. We're gonna like potentially win the exchange. So d takes e4 doesn't seem that attractive. So black played knight f6, and now e5, knight d7, bishop f4. So strong pointing e5, bishop c5, queen g4, looking at g7, and already black seems to have some difficulties. If castles, this might run into something horrible or not. Maybe not immediately, but it looks pretty dangerous. Black actually was a bit nervous perhaps and played king f8. So technically that's not as great apparently. Knight c3 was played, bishop d4. So e5, attacking e5, queen g3, stepping back, still looking at e5 and g7. Queen c7, attacking here again, protecting here. Doesn't matter about this pawn, it's trivial. C5 will be dangerous or something horrible after that. Let's have a quick look though. Bishop takes c3. If black was greedy, I think it's going to get destroyed. This didn't happen. I think just white's better with something like this and maybe this. The rooks are not connected. Black's in no position to win that material. So we see actually black playing rook b8. This is a big problem. And now here, a crushing blow. I wonder if it's... Can anyone spot what white played in this position? If I give you 20 seconds starting from now. So white play. By the way, on the previous game, sorry, about the mate, and Natalia has mentioned if it's two, there might be two moves, one's faster, though it makes sense to save energy and find the one way of winning. The simpler the better. So this idea of finding the most clinical, precise moves. Sometimes it's not worth it, because I think in human chess, the idea is just to win the game. You don't have to play like a computer every single move. I think that's Natalia's highlight there from that previous game. But anyway, here, White has a crushing tactical blow, giving a big advantage. So I hope you can see it. Knight takes d5. So this bishop is perfect for skewering the queen and rook here. Queen a5. So if e takes, this looks very, very painful with e6. Is it even more painful than I imagined? If queen b6, then yes, not even taking here. This is not even the point. But pardon me. The point is here, even stronger, bishop d6 check. And then if here, e7. And this is devastating, queening the pawn. So this is a really crushing tactic, just for this pawn and this bishop d6. Forget about that. So it wasn't taken, actually. If we just have a little bit more on this position. I mean, what does black actually play here? We just queen. Yeah, we don't have to discuss that too much, though. Okay, so queen a5 was played. And the knight just now drops back to e3. Okay, and this is quite... actually, there's a potential threat of knight f5 now, looking at g7. And again, using e6. Black snaps this off. Queen takes e3. Rook takes b2. Now, rook ec1. So this c-file is pretty dangerous. Bishop moves to b7. But now there's loose pieces around. Double attack on them. Queen d4. Queen d5, looking at g2. Does this help black? Not really. Queen takes d5. This is a murderous position for black. Still. So you might wonder why. Why not bishop takes d5 here? This wasn't played. If bishop takes d5, then check. And we can just take this rook. So black was forced to play e takes d5. And now this invasion to the 7th rank. Rook c7. King tries to protect there. But now this is a nasty pin. Bishop f5, intensifying the pressure on the pin. Bishop c8. And this gets pretty cute quickly now. Bishop g5 check. Look at these bishops. Amazing. f6. What else? If the king stepped back, then rook takes c8. So f6 virtually forced. I think f6 was forced. E takes, opening up the e-file. G takes. Rook e1 check. Now, if the king steps to d6, then this move is a disaster. Bishop f4 check. If knight e5, then white can now switch with rook ec1 to threaten mate here. And this is a disaster. So black actually played king d8 here, which doesn't help too much, because now a fantastic final little finishing tactic. it's actually a brilliant little tactic, because it's unfortunate that these rooks are here. That's a little clue. Can you see what white plays in this position? If I gave you 20 seconds starting from now. So white play here. How does white finish nicely here? So can you see what white played in this position? If I give you 20 seconds now. Oh, by the way, there was a question to Natalia on YouTube. So how do you still find good moves when you're tired or in time pressure? And the answer is, Natalia's mentioned, you've got to avoid time pressure. Simple as that. And Natalia's mentioned, my point is, people tend to blunder when being tired. So if you see an easy win, don't go for something flashy, especially if it looks risky. So white play here, finished off with rook takes d7 check, because after bishop takes f6. This is really unfortunate for black. King c7, bishop takes b2, still looking at this rook, so it's hopeless. Black resigned here. That was way back in the day, 1998. I've really enjoyed this session. I hope some of you did. And Talia, if maybe we can do some more games of yours next week if you're going to be around, because this was quite entertaining for me as well to see your comments. So maybe next week, on Tuesday, I'll be back to Tuesday next week. I hope everyone enjoyed this session with guests on YouTube, Natalia Pogonia. I think I'm trying to get the name a bit better. I've been trying to hear the pronunciation on chessgames.com. Natalia Pogonia. I hope that's a bit better than before anyway. So comments or questions on YouTube, and thanks for Natalia for coming as well. Fantastic. Okay, so see you all next week at the more usual time, Tuesday, 8 p.m. I'll be streaming on YouTube. Thanks very much.